This is Alex Meixner, and this is Real Life, Real Music.
Real Life, Real Music Radio, with your host, Kyle Hutton.
Well, it's funny about the handshake, because like I've been doing that since I was in middle school. And last week I was in Louisiana and did a program called Accordion Kings with Steve Riley from the Mamou Playboys, who's like the greatest Cajun accordion player on the planet. Yves Lambert came from Quebec, an Acadian accordionist. Geno de la Fosse, awesome Zydeco guy and one of the funniest people I've ever met. And Josh Baca from Los Tex-Maniacs was representing the Conjunto, and Glenn Hartman from the New Orleans Klezmer All-Stars. So I go to shake Gino's hand, and I go do my snap, and he's like, oh, Michael Doucet does the same thing from Beausoleil. I'm like, dude, I've admired Michael Doucet and Beausoleil for my entire life, and I didn't know that I had the same handshake.
Good company, good company. Well, Alex, thank you so much for coming to hang out with us tonight, and rumor has it that you traveled all the way from Huntsville to be here with us.
Well,
today
this is one of the close gigs, you know. I mean, I came from Huntsville and I didn't have to get a work release to get out.
There you go, perfect.
So my longtime original sax player, Dr. Michael William Patrick Fortunato, is living in Huntsville. So he's going to be playing with us this weekend for the rest of our gigs. And in fact, he's probably going to jump up here and play a few tunes with us tonight.
I got to hear him during soundcheck, so I can't wait. Well, I tell you what, we're going to have lots of time to talk about what's going on with you. I am already just enthralled by the conversations that we've been having, and really feel like I'm sitting at the feet of someone who understands some of the very niche areas of music that have had a huge influence on the state of Texas. And so we're going to talk about that. But I wonder if you would just pick up one of your instruments and kick us off with a song tonight.
Okay. So let's see here. I'm trying to think, what is the appropriate set starter here? I'm going to do something a little uncommon for me. I'm going to start with something slow and pretty. Okay, everybody go, ah. And this is a little song that I composed quite a few years ago. In 12 and a half years ago, to be exact. It was written for my first daughter, for Zoe Lynn. And it is a little waltz. And you know, a waltz, three-quarter time, it just has a way of just a lilt. And when you're very stressed, or you're upset in any way, shape, or form, there's just something about a pretty little waltz that just lets you just glide through life. And, you know, I'm known for playing some pretty loud, raucous, fast, I don't know, like, and this guy's like, Crazy Train! But sometimes we just gotta take it a little purdy. And so this is for my daughter, Zoe Lynn.
Thank you. Thank you.
Now, the young lady that you composed that for is now embarking on her own musical journey.
Yes, Zoe is 12 years old, and she plays the flute in the school band back in home in Florida. And she plays a little bit of piano, and she's written some songs and that kind of stuff, and she sings and that kind of bit. But she took up the flute primarily because that was the instrument that almost caused me to not get my degree in music. Of all of my secondary instruments, flute was an instrument that these big lips were not meant to play.
So. That was hilarious. Okay, so your daughters that are embarking, and son, right, is also
correct.
Playing?
Okay,
yes. So, but they are fifth generation musicians in your family. Back us up that lineage a little bit to how music got started in your family.
Well, the music got started in this country. Four generations ago, my great-grandfather emigrated from what is now called Burgenland in Austria, and he was a Kapellmeister, an orchestra leader. He played the cornet, and he played the violin, and then he led the band, and my grandfather and all of his brothers and sisters had to play a band instrument and an orchestral instrument. My grandfather played trumpet, and he also played drums. And then he was a bass player in the band. He eventually became the rock and roller. I mean, Pop liked to play things loud. He, in fact, got fired from the family orchestra after my great-grandfather had passed. He got fired because he dared to have a Fender electric bass that lasted for one gig. And then my father, of course, he grew up in that environment as well. His first gigs, he would stand on a... When my grandfather would play the trumpet, he would stand on an accordion case to play the upright bass, because the electric bass was too big for him at that time. And then my dad went off to college in Pittsburgh, went to Duquesne University, and was a member of a group called the Tamburitzins, which is an Eastern European folk ensemble. And he was a string bass major, accordion, button accordion, bass, keyboards, all that stuff.
Wow.
Produced albums, was my inspiration. And I played in my dad's band. At one time with my grandfather and my two sisters, the Meixner Kinder.
That's cool.
And with my dad's band, came to Texas for the first time, you know, and it's just like, and it was totally amazing the first time down here, going to New Braunfels. There's only one S in New Braunfels. You'll find it right at the end. There's not one in the middle. Spell it with me, my friends. We'll do that later. But I got down here and, you know, didn't quite know what to take of it. You know, there's Lederhosen, like at all of our other German gigs, and there's cowboy boots, and, you know.
Well, we're glad you found it.
I'm certainly glad. And man, the mix of the Texas Czechs and Germans and Poles. And it, man, I just was like, this is an amazing cross-section where they just respect and enjoy each other's cultures and just let it grow from there.
Well, since we started with something a little more tame, then maybe an ode to your pop would be for you to pick something a little more rambunctious to play for us.
Okay, so, Skeeter. you know, I think... this guy here looks like he wants a rock and roll cover. I mean, it's just... And so one of the things that I like to do is I like to take songs that are familiar to certain populations and put them in a context that is unfamiliar to that population and then take that context. And, you know, it brings people together through music. So this is a song written by a gentleman named Ozzy Osbourne. And... this is allowing us to show the closet accordion players of America creed that everything sounds better as a polka is correct. All right, so I'm gonna need a little bit of help as I do a song about a form of transportation that rides on wheels that's a little less than sane. I
crazy, but that's how it goes. Millions of people living as folks. Maybe it's not too late to learn how to love and forget how to hate. Better ones not healing, driving me insane. I'm going off the rails on a crazy train. I'm going off the rails on a crazy train. Take the last train to Clarksville and I'll meet you at the station. We'll be there by 4:20 cause I made your reservation. Don't be slow. Oh no no no. Oh no no no. Cause I'm leaving in the morning and I won't see you again. We'll have one night together till the morning brings my train and I must go. Oh no no no. Oh no no no. And I don't care if I'm ever coming home. Crazy, crazy for feeling so blue. I knew you'd love me as long as you wanted. And then someday you'll leave me for somebody new. Somebody make some noise! I was in the preachers, I was in the pools. I watched all the dropouts who make their own rules. One person condition to rule and control. Media sells it, and you buy the role. Mental wounds not healing, driving me insane. I'm going off the rail on a crazy train. I'm going off the rail on a crazy train. Somebody sing the Chattanooga Choo Choo. Pardon me, boy. That Chattanooga Choo Choo. Thank you, music lovers.
Yeah. So I think you know you've mastered an instrument that would be you know probably seen by most as kind of an old world. It's been around for a long time. It's a little bit more obscure than some other mainstream type instruments.
You know, you're being very politically correct about this.
I'm choosing my words very carefully.
I mean, come on. This is one of the most ridiculed musical instruments of the history of humanity.
Misunderstood.
When I was living in Pennsylvania, I was doing these Pennsylvania Artists in Education conferences, and there were two other dudes that were like, we should start the most hated band in the world. I would play accordion, one guy was gonna play banjo, and the other one was gonna play bagpipes. I mean, we had the ability to offend everybody with one of those instruments. But again, there's beauty is in the eyes of the beholder.
Yeah. Well, you know, one of the things that I like is, just like with that last number that you did, you're kind of like the Tiger Woods of the accordion. You're taking an old sport and you're bringing it to a new audience.
Dude, he ain't doing so well these days. For it.
Leave out all the bad stuff that he did. I mean, Tiger Woods, the good stuff that he
yes.
did.
He revolutionized golf.
He revolutionized it as you are revolutionizing.
Well,
the
thing is that what I'm proud of is that not only four generations of my family, you know, this instrument sort of is Texas, because it has been used in every culture and in every form of traditional music in the last 150 years. And here in Texas alone, you have some of the greatest virtuosos to ever play the instrument specifically. I mean, if you look on the conjunto side, Flaco Jimenez, Mingo Saldivar, and up till now where you have guys like Josh Baca, you know, who are just, and man, it's all one big accordion tree, and there's just these different branches that come off of it. And, you know, I mean, Ponte Bone was in Austin, rest his soul, and that man was like one badass rock and roller that played the accordion. I mean, Augie Myers. And so you look at it, and that history of crossing those cultural boundaries, whether it's the Mexican side of the tree, the German side of the tree, the Czech side of the tree, and a country grew out of all of that.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you listen to the old Bob Wills and Spade Cooley kind of stuff. There's yodeling going on. Well, I mean, come on. There were German cowboys. You know, I mean, that's and that's the beauty of it, because here I see that the Western swing, how it's respected.
Yeah. You know,
Jason Roberts leading the band, and it's that to me, you don't find that as regularly and as easily in other parts of the United States of America, you know? And so it's one of the reasons that I love coming to Texas so much, because there's a love for the history and the evolution of music.
Yeah. So is there, when you think about that, and you think about the time that you have spent in New Braunfels, okay? And, you know, and man, I mean, as a kid, I can remember growing up and, you know, going to Worst Fest and going like and it was almost to some degree, being from Houston, like you were in another world, because there was this, you know, intersection of German and Czech, and it was just an amazing experience that was totally different than where I was from. So if I made you pick one composition that you felt like was the most Texas composition, which one would that be?
Well, you know, I mean, we got to go back to three-quarter time here, because I'll tell you, this represents the attitude of Texas and the attitude of my audiences as it has gone everywhere, you know? There's this song that I actually was inspired by a German guy, and he was Bavarian. And I always say Texas is the Bavaria of the United States, you know, because it's Willkommen zum Freistaat Bayern. Welcome to the free state of Bavaria. You know, there's just that pride in being Bavarian. That's pride of being a Texan. And this was a Bavarian guy in Fort Wayne, Indiana, and their band, Die Freudemacher, the Merrymakers. And he would stand on top of his Krumar organ at 11 o'clock in the morning, and he would yell out this phrase that became a battle cry for my band. and is our most popular song, written by a buddy of mine from Pittsburgh for us. And his battle cry was, "If you drink, you're gonna die. If you don't drink, you're gonna die. So why die thirsty? If you drink, you're gonna die. If you don't drink, you're gonna die. So why die thirsty? Why die thirsty? Why die thirsty? Let's have a drink. Why die thirsty? Why die thirsty? Why die thirsty? Let's all have a drink. One week the experts say something's bad, the next week they say it is fine. How can you know what is really true when the experts can't make up their mind? If you drink, you're gonna die. If you don't drink, you're gonna die. So why die thirsty? Why die thirsty? Why die thirsty? Let's have a drink. Why die thirsty? Why die thirsty? Why die thirsty? Let's all have a drink. Someone I've looked to for good advice, my grandfather's been very wise. He's been no stranger to a shot and beer, and he's now 95. If you drink, you're gonna die. If you don't drink, you're gonna die. So why die thirsty? Why die thirsty? Why die thirsty? Let's have a drink. Why die thirsty? Why die thirsty? Why die thirsty? Let's all have a drink. Red meat, eggs, butter, and beer or wine, my friend would never touch. He ate right and got sleep and exercise, but then he got hit by a bus. If you drink, you're gonna die. If you don't drink, you're gonna die. So why die thirsty? Why die thirsty? Why die thirsty? Let's have a drink. Why die thirsty? Why die thirsty? Why die thirsty? Let's all have a drink.
Prost.
That song goes over well in Texas for more than one reason, for many, many, many reasons.
Well, I mean, you guys have some good beer in Texas, you know what I mean?
We do, and I'll give a shout out, you know, right here in this area, there's some great little breweries in Magnolia and Conroe.
I'm just going to say I have to be partial to a brewery in New Braunfels.
Yes.
Because New Braunfels, the Faust Brewery makes the Alex Meixner Polka Pills beer. But I mean, hey, let's hear it first.
We got to try it.
The National Beer of Texas is a good one, too. You know, I mean,
It is.
It's all good times. But yeah, we need to get some polka pills over here.
Yeah, we got to try that. I'm looking over at the owners right now, and the wife's shaking her head, and Steve's going, "Yes, honey." Yes, honey, we'll do that. Okay, while we've got the audience warmed up, let's get the liner that we need to start the radio show, okay? And that's going to look like, this is Alex Meixner, and this is Real Life, Real Music. And then I need you guys to go nuts, okay? All right.
This is Alex Meixner, and this is Real Life, Real Music.
That was perfect. Wow.
Have they been drinking?
I saw the orders coming in after that song, man. The bar is stacked up now. Okay, so let me ask you this. You spend a lot of time. Well, of course you're a dad. Okay, so that's you know, one thing. Second thing, you spend a lot of time not only talking with young people about like the fundamentals of music, right? But you also talk about what I would consider the more communal functions of music, that have to do with uniting, whether it's, you know, cultures or communities, or you spend a lot of time in schools. Tell us a little bit about that side of what you do.
That is probably the most important aspect of what I can do. I've gone to college, gotten degrees in music, and studied classical and jazz and ethnomusicology and all of this kind of stuff. But I feel, we were talking about this a little earlier, you know, music breaks down and communicates in ways when words fail. And, you know, we live in a world in which it seems there's always a reason to be offended or pissed off. You know, I mean, oh my God, that person voted for somebody that I don't vote for. This person goes to that church that I don't want to go to or whatever. You know, oh my, they're from West Texas and not West comma Texas. You know, they're from that other country, West. You know, I mean, there's always a reason. It seems that people are building barriers with each other. And do you know what? I think that that's one of the things that the accordion itself, as much as it is derided, there's a certain community amongst accordion players. You know, I mean, like, we've all heard the jokes, you know, about the accordion player who was coming home from his gig one night, and he saw a few of his friends' cars were parked at a local bar, so he's like, oh, I'm going to go in and have a beer, see my buddies. Comes out and sees the back window of his car is smashed. He's like, oh, no, my accordion was in there. And he sees two more accordions are in it. You know, you know, and it's just like the instrument brings us together and music brings us together. So when I go into schools, I'm like, okay, look, you come from this ancestral background. You come from this ancestral background. But this instrument, your grandparents played this and they danced to it. And, you know, whether it is the blue skirt waltz with a lot of the Czechs or the Slovenians, or, you know, it's one of the Mexican bolero ballads, you know, there's just so much gorgeous music to be made. And we need to just bring it together and be nice to each other. And that's why I share the stage sometimes with people who are virtuoso, amazing musicians that I don't have the right to carry their instrument cases. And at the same time, I want to show the same respect when I have one of the old timers get up and play with me, or one of the kids. Man, there's nothing like watching a kid that's just finding out how this instrument can bring it together. Yeah. You know, I see the Vrajal shirt, you know, and I mean, man, I mean, playing at Westfest, the last year the Vrajals band existed, was just, and I got to stand up there between Alfred and Anton, and I mean, I'm just like, man, that is just a history of music and a communal love. And you can just sit there and play Ayasam over and over again, and watching all the generations sing along to that song and go, this is what humanity needs more of.
Absolutely, you know? No doubt. I think we'd all probably agree with that right yeah. now. Are you running for office? Because I'll vote for you.
I'm starting a new political party. It's the Polka Party. My whole thing is that if you got a problem, drink more beer. Let's stop thinking. Let's start drinking.
There you go. I like it. The campaign slogan for the road. Okay, so you play, you sit in with all kinds of bands, as you just said, Los Tex Maniacs. You mentioned Flaco Jimenez. Play us something. Take us south of the border. Play us something that is going to remind us of how that instrument influences Hispanic and Mexican music.
Okay, so this is a song that was made popular by Tony de la Rosa, and he was one of the big conjunto accordion players, but he stole the song. Okay, he called it El Circo, but it is actually a banjo song, like from the 20s or 30s, called Alabama Jubilee. But it's a song that's got that polka beat, and it's like funny because I first played this song at a folk festival in Massachusetts when they had drawing a blank on the conjunto that was there, but it was not one of the bigger ones. They had like a generational thing on music. So they had a conjunto family that was there. I'm going to really be sad that I'm forgetting this name. It's going to come to me after the session's done. And then there was an Appalachian banjo player and then me. And we did this Alabama Jubilee or El Circo. So...
Now, you mentioned your father is one of your inspirations, and you got to play a lot of shows with him, starting in about the seventh grade. I mean, why mow lawns when you can play gigs, right? Tell us about those first live performances.
Well, actually, even before then, my sisters and I performed. I would sing, and I attempted to play the trumpet. That started Jamie Ross's kicking my butt in trumpet auditions. A high school trumpet buddy of mine is here over here. A nice round of applause for Mr. James Ross. And I played the accordion. But then when I was in seventh grade, I was working two nights a week playing at the Bavarian Schnitzel House on International Drive in Orlando. I was playing the drums. And, you know, it would be like, I'd be playing something. Ding-ga-ding-ga-ding-ga-ding-ga, and my dad would be like... Then it'd be like, okay, that's bad. No, that's not. You know, and that would go on for like 2 years, but that, the real life experience, and like, man, getting a buck and a half a night to go play drums. And I, of course, never drank any beer or anything at a German restaurant, you know. I mean, that would have been illegal, you know. So I never did that. But, you know, I mean, a good experience. I played a lot with musicians who were much more experienced than I was, and that made me learn how to get from A to B on a gig. Yeah. And it would be like, okay, 1 week it was doing the German polka Slovenian thing with my dad, and then it would be like, oh, the mariachi guys were coming over. So I was like getting that thing going on with the trumpet and like learning from jazz guys in Orlando and playing shows, and it's good times. And then off to college and...
Yeah,
trying to be an educated musician.
Well, one of the places that the journey ended up taking you to was sharing the stage with the London Symphony Orchestra. That's an amazing, like, how did that come about? And then I don't know if you play something you played with them or whatever, but just give us a feel for that part of?
So that did not include the accordion.
Okay.
So I was a junior in high school, and every other year, the London Symphony Orchestra would do a two-week residency in Daytona Beach, Florida. And they had auditions that would take two trumpet players from the Southeast, because they made a brass quintet. So two trumpets, tuba, trombone, French horn. They had two string quartets, so two violins, viola, and cello, and then a woodwind quintet, which is clarinet, flute, bassoon, French horn. I don't know all the instruments. Oh, wow, it's been a few years since I've been having to deal with woodwind quintets. Hey, Fort.
Speaking of.
So, well, and 2 weeks of intense study of classical literature and watching Michael Tilson Thomas, one of the greatest conductors of history and one of the greatest symphony orchestras. We were coached by members of the orchestra and went to concerts for 2 weeks. It was an amazing experience. I was not mature enough to appreciate. I mean, like, I can remember falling asleep in a concert one time because I was so tired. And I look back at that, and I'm going to be, I better admit that, because I was not as cultured and understanding as some of the other kids. But, I mean, it was pretty awesome.
Yeah.
Though, one of my show pieces on the button accordion comes directly from that experience. So, the culmination experience was that all of the student musicians played in the orchestra for a concert. And the last piece that we played was Aaron Copland's Hoedown from Rodeo. And I remember sitting there going, a hoedown and a symphony orchestra doesn't quite go. And so I figured that the hoedown should be done with the button accordion, because that's much more appropriate for a hoedown. I mean, I hadn't been to Texas yet, but, you know, I guess it was in my soul and my brain a little bit. So this little melody.
Thank you.
You know, what I mean, what's amazing to me as a musician is I don't know that I've ever seen that one. You know what I mean? Like that type of chord. And the bass, I'm sitting right here, and the bass that is coming out of that is, it's crazy.
So this is a diatonic instrument, which means that it only plays technically in a key of G, C, F, and B flat. And each one of the buttons is different, whether I go in and out.
Okay.
So it's sort of like having four harmonicas next to each other. Okay. Then this specific kind, because like the Mexican Hohner Coronas, they're not infected with the virus. Or the Gabinellis, most of the time they don't use the left hand. They take the reeds out, and they also have some extra trick chromatic buttons up here. So when Flacco plays, he can play a full chromatic scale. This instrument does not have those trick buttons. But our left hand has heligon reeds, and a heligon is the ancestral name of a tuba. Because Germans love heavy metal. And this instrument, my father was recognized as one of the best in the United States. Wow. On this instrument. He did the first recordings that anybody on this side of the Atlantic did of solo button accordion, where he would show off both hands and the unique tonal range of the instrument and it playing folk melodies for the most part and original compositions of his own.
Wow. Hey, is everybody doing okay out there? Y'all having a good time so far tonight? Okay. All right. Okay, because I'm just mesmerized up here. This is amazing. All right, so you have been involved in over 60 commercial recordings. Okay, so and I'm guessing that's projects that you've released or projects that you've been involved in. I want to ask you specifically about one from 2016, the Polka King with Jack Black.
Oh.
I have to know, what was that like?
An experience that was just absolutely amazing. First of all, the movie, it's available on Netflix. The Polka King is the life story of Jan Lewandowski, a singer from Poland who defected to Canada. And then eventually to the United States. He was a singer, band leader. He got a Grammy nomination. He's a real life person. He ran tours to Poland. He also ran many tours to the Vatican because he had forged a friendship when he was in Canada with Cardinal Wojtyla, who became Pope John Paul II. And at the same time, he was importing Polish amber jewelry and religious relics, and he needed investors. And this is where the story makes a left turn. And he was taking investment money from his fans and selling securities, and it was a little bit of a Ponzi scheme. And well, it landed dear Yannick in prison. And while in prison, he had his throat slit and almost didn't come out of prison. But alas, Jan Levon has paid his debt to society. In his prison term, he will work till his dying day. He teaches piano lessons to kids in West Palm Beach, Florida. And I got this phone call while I was on the road somewhere, like Chicago or something. I get this phone call, and Jan Levon is calling me. And he's like, Alex, I don't know if you remember me, but I'm Jan Levon. I'm like, how can I forget a guy that would ride in on a white chariot to gigs? I mean, this guy, he was the Tom Jones of polka music. I mean, he would be up on stage in this rhinestone suit. He's a little guy, and ladies would be waving their handkerchiefs and other things. And I mean, and it
It was like nothing you'd ever seen in your life before. He's like, Alex, they make movie about my life, and Jack Black going to play me in movie, and they want my band to play, but the accordion player, he passed away. Well, he was killed in the bus accident. And so I got to play with Jan's old band, many of which I had known from other places through the years. And we're in Avatar Studios, the former power station in New York City, which is where some of the greatest albums of all time were made. I mean, everything from Bon Jovi to Sting to Sheryl Crow to, I mean, anything that wasn't made in Texas or Nashville was made at Power Station, right? So the third best recordings, right? and Jack comes in, and for 2 days, one of the most sincerely true, authentic individuals. Like, when you see Jack Black in a movie, that's Jack Black, period. I mean, he's cracking jokes. He is just a sweetheart, and he is just the life of a party. Like, we went out to go get pizza and beer in Manhattan the one day after the end of recording, and we're standing at the bar waiting in line to get seats, and he doesn't pull the "I'm Jack Black, make a table." You know, I mean, it's like, he's totally awesome. And there's this lady talking to him, and she's like, "You look kind of familiar." And he's like, "You do too. Where did you go to high school?" And she's like, "Somewhere on Long Island." He goes, "Nah, I'm from Laguna Beach, California." And her daughter is like hitting her, going, "Mom, it's Jack Black." He learned how to sing in Polish, and he just nailed it. As he said, "I was born to be Jan Levon," you know? But then when the movie came out, and this is my favorite part of the story, when the movie came out, we all got called to go up. Netflix needed to promote the movie, so they brought all the musicians into New York again. We did an appearance on the Stephen Colbert Show and on the Today Show. And my girlfriend at the time, Paula, she's a huge Jack Black fan. So she's like, "Can I come?" And I'm like, "Yeah, that'd be awesome." Meanwhile, I had been to see a friend of mine in New Braunfels, who's a jeweler, and I had gotten a ring for her. And I was like, So it's like, I see Jack during the rehearsal. I'm talking to him for a little bit. I'm like, "Dude, I've been walking around New York all day with this ring in my pocket." And he's like, "Dude, I'm already married." I'm like, "No worries. My girl's going to come take a picture with you. Can you say something nice about me?" You know, I mean, just like, and so in effect, Jack Black was my wingman when I proposed to Paula.
That is awesome.
You know, so he's there telling her about how his wife plays the accordion a little bit. His wife, her father was one of the greatest jazz bass players of all time, Charlie Hayden. And his family, they were contemporaries of the Carter family in traditional, like, bluegrass country music. And then he goes to take a selfie, because Jack always takes selfies. And when he turns Paula around, I'm on my knee on top of a monitor speaker. And Paula was like, it took 2 days until I verified that she said yes to my proposal and didn't think she was marrying Jack. But I mean, it was, and to this day, I'm now married to a Texan, and I'm a lucky man.
So how about play us a traditional polka?
Okay, a traditional polka. Well, you know,
is there any other kind?
Well, there are.
All right.
You know, I mean, and so that's the thing. Polka is a genre that is got so much complexity and simplicity, sometimes at the same time. So a lot of our music is based on folk melodies. The dance itself comes from Bohemia, a Czech region, in bordering in Poland, going on further, and that's where the actual dance emanates from. But the music itself, there's aspects of polka music in so many different cultures. And then you have people that compose new polkas that will have jazz chords in them, or they have elements of other kinds of popular music. So it's a constantly evolving music, you know? So, but I'm going to play a little song for our Czech friends here, because I think they know Ayasam.
Své chodničky odsedlám, a já sám kdečký sám. Své chodničky odsedlám, své chodničky očeruju, svoj panenku pomeluju, a já sám kdečký sám. Své kotečky odsedla.
And so there you have a traditional melody, and then you'll have a secondary part that I just put on there, the second part that was in. And that's one that I picked up from one of the Czech bands in like Ohio or something like that. Bands will put different kickers on them, and okay. they will develop to lengthen the song for the dancing audiences. And then just like you'll have that, you've got that tempo. If I'm playing, that would be about a typical Texas Czech tempo. Now, when we play in Cleveland, they dance to a faster beat. And so doing a similar type song, but I'll do a German one because we have a bunch of people here from the Tomball German Heritage Festival. And so they like to kick the beat a little faster, and I know the Tomball crew likes to kick things a little faster sometimes. So this is a little German one that's called Mussi Den, which was a Schwäbische Volkslieder that was made popular in the movie G.I. Blues by Elvis Presley.
Musi den, so steht der Lehen aus, so du mein Schatz bleibst hier. Wenn ich komm, wenn ich wieder komm, kehr ich ein, mein Schatz, bei dir. Han ich gleich nicht allbald bei dir sein, han ich doch mein Freud an dir. Wenn ich komm, wenn ich wieder komm, kehr ich ein, mein Schatz, bei dir.
And you can pick one of these up on your way out, the Tomball German Heritage Festival. It'll be March 27th through the 29th, and you'll be there, right?
I will be there all 3 days. I will be there along with the hostess with the mostest, our great friend, Belina Polka. Belina will be there, and with Das ist Lustig, her husband, Ross. And Belina is also selling our merch today. And complete portions of the proceeds. In fact, the entire proceeds go to benefit the families. My family. my three beautiful children.
So yes. You go. I like that. So, stop by the merch table after the show. But you brought a buddy with you all the way from Huntsville.
All the way from Huntsville. And he also is not out on work release. Let's have a nice round of applause. Originally from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and now seeing the light living in Huntsville, Texas. Everybody, a nice round of applause for Dr. Michael William Patrick Fortunato!
Okay, so now that it's a dynamic duo, you will have to pick what you're going to play and tell us about it.
Well, we're going to do a little song,
do a little song.
It's amazing that I need lyrics for the stuff that I write because I don't get to play it as much.
I need to warm up first. Okay, give him a few notes. Okay.
Oh, that is beautimous. This is a little tune that I wrote with a buddy of mine from California named Paul Lax. And Paul has a band out there called Icy Hawks in LA. And they're like an alternative country group. And this is sort of a Zydeco flavored tune that is on the Three Ring Circus album. And also on our latest album, we did a new version of it when we added the fiddle to the band. The album is called Make Some Noise. Okay, hold on. I don't know if the microphone's working. That album is called Make Some Noise! Okay, so a little song is called Baby Say Maybe. 2, 3, 4.
Walked into the corner to get myself out of my head. You stole on by and your mystery smile reminded me I ain't dead yet. I'm just looking for a baby, pretty baby. Oh baby, just a baby would be sweet. Just tell me baby, pretty baby. Oh baby, maybe baby, you weren't meant for me. Well, here I am down on the corner, a flower in my foolish head. By, I'll play the fool, I'll say hi. Won't you come and see me with my man? I'm just looking for a baby, pretty baby. Oh baby, just a baby would be sweet. Tell me baby, pretty baby. Oh baby, maybe baby, you were meant for me. Looking for a baby, pretty baby. Oh, maybe just a baby would be sweet. Just tell me, baby, pretty baby. Oh, baby, maybe, baby, you were meant for me.
Dr. Michael William Patrick Fortunato.
Wow. Okay, so you and I were talking upstairs, and you said that Willie Nelson got his start in a polka band. Is that right?
Of course.
All right. So, and you guys were kind of playing around a little bit at sound check with a couple of old standards that, you know, Willie and a bunch of people, you know, they will choose a standard and make it their own. I don't remember exactly which one you guys were playing at
soundcheck. We were doing All of Me.
Yes.
Do you got that one too?
I don't, but I want to hear y'all play it.
Okay. Okay, just a beautiful song. And you know, I mean, All of Me, why not take all of me? And basically, I mean, it's a song in which she dumped him. I mean, come on. So let's not be too sad and actually sing it. you know. So, and in fact, I just love the beauty and the pain and the beauty of the pain that goes into Dr. Fort's clarinet. Let's have a round of applause for Fort. Give it up for Dr. Fortunato.
Very nice. Amazing. Amazing. You know, I think about this old radio right here sits in between me and my guest artist every show. And I just imagine hearing what y'all just did coming out of that speaker right there way
some
back
of the,
when.
Some of the best music in the world came off of radios like this.
Crazy, isn't it? Yeah. Are y'all having a good time tonight? I'm having an amazing time. This is great.
Like, I love listening to all different kinds of music. And lately on my Kindle, because when you're traveling as much as I do in the band, when I'm not driving, you know, I have my Kindle on because it's a little healthier for me than social media and that kind of stuff to just read and educate yourself. So I love reading biographies. And I've been on a string of reading about the backgrounds of a lot of different musicians, you know, and whether it's Miles Davis or Jerry Lee Lewis, And right now, I just started, got off the music thing. I'm reading a biography of Jimmy Carter. And it's just interesting how you have these different mindsets of humanity. And man, so much great stuff happened in the past. And whenever we're moving forward, you want to build on a foundation. And so a radio like this, make sure you listen to some music that was played originally when it first came out on something like this. It lets you understand and build. Make that house a really good one with a foundation. And now the man.
All right, so I've got a question. Since you're here,
I might have an answer.
I want to, I would love it if you would join me on a song. And this is a song, across the few records that I've done, there always seems to be at least one song on the record, and I would get lumped into that singer-songwriter Americana kind of realm, but there's always one that just requires the drone that only the accordion can.
Well, I'm anxious to get to play a song.
Can produce. So this is going to be one of those, softer singer-songwritery deals. But I know you will be able to just jump right in. Are you still getting this back there, David? You seeing that? Okay, so I spent the first 10 years of my life in the South Houston area, and then I moved up to Dallas and made my way back down here chasing a girl after college. And I did catch her, which is a good thing. And speaking of college, I went to school at Texas A&M University just up the road. And in about, I think it's April 1st, if you check your upcoming events sheet, the Texas Aggieland Orchestra will be up here on the stage with me as the band director conducts his last show after a 39-year career. And we will be here sharing that moment with them on our radio program. And so if you're enjoying the format tonight, come back and see us at the beginning of April for that show. So this song, I wrote this about growing up here in the Houston area. So I used a few different Houston landmarks. But the thought process was, if Jesus lived in Houston, where would he hang out? And I thought that was kind of an interesting thought process and conversation. So I don't know if this is right or wrong, but this was my answer to that question. All right, it goes something like this. Jesus lived in Houston, he'd walk down Quitman Street, where you can find a dime bag or anything you need. See the hooker at the corner crying at his feet. If Jesus lived in Houston, he'd walk down Quitman Street. Jesus lived in Houston, he'd stroll through River Oaks, talk with politicians, tax collectors, finer folks. He'd start each conversation with his favorite lawyer jokes. If Jesus lived in Houston, he'd stroll through River Oaks. Yeah, and he'd tell us that we need him, and tell us that he loves us, and most would just ignore him, and we'd go on with our lives. But he'd say this ground is holy, cause we're all walking on it. Holy land that's worth enough to die. Jesus lived in Houston, he'd walk Montrose Avenue. See nobody different than he sees me or you. He'd start each conversation by a round or two.
Jesus lived in Houston, he'd walk Montrose Avenue. Yeah, and he tell us that we need him. Tell us that he loves us. And most just ignore him and we'd go on with our lives. But he'd say this ground is holy, cause we're all walking on it. Holy land that's worthy enough to die. Yeah. Jesus lived in Houston, I know he'd walk down mine. Cause heaven knows I need him all the time. Yeah, he might even move in to help me walk the line. If Jesus lived in Houston, I know he'd walk down mine. If Jesus lived in Houston, I know he'd walk down by.
Come on, make some noise, people.
Thank you very much. I figured if I was going to write a song about Jesus, I should write one that would make everybody mad.
Do you know, there's a band out of California that I've done some shows with called the Red Elvises, and they did an album that was called Drinking with Jesus.
Yeah?
And, yeah, that one was a little more irreverent. Like, though, look, man, you know, he hung out with all the worst people of society, and he gave them a chance. We're all sinners in some way, shape, and form. You know, not to get all preachy on everybody, but I mean, none of us are perfect. So, I mean.
Yeah, well, and you know, and the bottom line is the message is predominantly about love, and we could use a lot more of that right now.
Exactly, and that's the most important part of it. You know, I mean, so accept ourselves. I think that's the most important part. We got to accept ourselves, and that will allow us to accept Jesus.
I agree completely. And the only thing that would help you when you leave here tonight accept yourself better would be if you were wearing one of Alex's new t-shirts that he has for sale over at the merch table. And
that was awesome.
So here's what we're gonna do. We've got time for, you know, a couple more that you want to play and tell us about. And then what we're going to do is, before Alex gets out of here, I mean, I'm getting a shirt, and you guys need to come get some stuff. Because here's what I'll tell you. This is what's funny about being in the music business. And you and I have been doing this. You've been doing it for longer than I have. I put out my first record in 1999. Guess what? 99. When people, like, came to the merch table in 1999... they bought CDs because you had to have them to listen to music.
Yeah.
Right? Now, it's totally cool. We get it. You can walk right out to your car that possibly does not even have a CD player anymore, and you can listen to any of the songs that any of us have written on demand and absolutely do that. But buy a t-shirt at the merch table because it equals like almost 60,000 streams if you were to listen to one of the songs. It's absolutely crazy. So if you can tonight, you got a little money left in your pocket on the way out, go pick up a t-shirt, CD, koozie, whatever they got over there, and let's
sometimes
send it
I sell
work.
Members of the band. You know, I mean, fourth single over there.
Should we do that? I mean, should we do that as like a live auction, or how do you want to do that? No, I'm just kidding. Come over and say hi to Alex after the show, and thank you guys for being such a respectful audience tonight. This has been a treat. What else do you want to play for us tonight, buddy?
Well, can I play one more slow song before I like kick another one up? Okay, I want to play a song that was written by my father. And Big Al passed last year. on the anniversary of his father passing.
Wow.
And also on the birthday of my oldest, his first grandchild. And it's kind of tough stuff. I mean, families are tough, you know, and I wouldn't be doing the thing that I'm doing today if it wasn't for my pops. And I hope he knows that, you know, because it wasn't easy. But I want to do what I think is one of his most beautiful songs. And it's a song that was written for my little sister. And it's just called the Katrina Walze.
I don't think, you know, I think part of, you know, the reason I'm so mesmerized tonight is because I've never had the opportunity to, like, just sit and watch. You know, if I've ever been playing where somebody, the keys player picks up the accordion, plays it for a couple songs or whatever, I'm never getting to just sit and watch like this. And even, like, just the little subtle vibrato that you – are you doing that by actually moving it, or is it a – is it a draw thing?
It's definitely the bellows. This is a wind instrument in that the air going through.
Yeah. There you go. Yeah.
And that is Flaco Jimenez at the end of a song.
Yeah.
Or Eddie Rodick, who's a Slovenian accordion guy up in Cleveland. He'll be in the middle of a waltz and just like... you have so many forms of expression. This instrument is like an extension of the body because you can feel the reeds vibrating. And, you know, they have fully electronic digital reedless accordions, and they work for some people. Hmm. But, and at the risk of I don't mean to be denigrating to that stuff, because you have so many options available. You have different kinds of tunings, right? You just hit that little screen at the top.
Yeah.
But it doesn't have that.
Yeah. Well, that's what I love watching. And you obviously, you play with your whole body from your hair to all the rest of you.
I got a little bit of it cut, you know. Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, yeah. And man, I've been sitting for an hour.
I know, it's
playing
crazy.
The accordion. I mean, this is so, like, for people that are used to seeing me play, they're like, oh my God, is there something wrong with Alex? You know what I mean? And I promise, you know, I love, sometimes it's nice to be able to sit and play the instrument, because then it allows me to play some of the repertoire I don't get to play when I'm playing with the band and running around the stage and all that kind of stuff. And I hope that it lets you listen to the music that I've been practicing, so that you can hear that I'm not just like, my all-time philosophy is every time I make a mistake, I shake my ass. So, I mean, and if you've ever seen one of my live performances, there's a lot of butt shaking going on. I mean, if I was able to play as perfect as Joey Miskelin, I'd sit in a chair all the time, you know?
Well, it has been an absolute pleasure for me, and I think I speak for all of us, that we've had a wonderful time tonight. Absolutely. I wonder...
Thank you.
Pick one for whatever reason you want to finish us off with tonight and tell us about it.
Okay. Going back over here. And I'm going to do a little song that I'm going to sing in Austrian. So I'm... It's for the Tomball German Heritage Festival. And this is a song that's on the Three Ring Circus album. It is a song that comes from Austria, not Australia. Wir haben kein Kangaroo. And it's a little yodeling song, okay? Called Bergwagabunden.
Wie der Klippen schwindel, der Helien kräben, dem der Pokre zu. In unseren Herzen lebt eine Sehnsucht, die lässt uns immer mit Ruhe. Heiliger Berg, jetzt sonnige Helien, Bergwagabunden sind wir, ja weh. Heiliger Berg, jetzt sonnige Helien, Bergwagabunden sind wir. Rauri, 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 radio, rauri, radio, rauri, radio, rauri, 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 radio, rauri, 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 somebody make some noise! Jetzt alle packen, alle zu wagen, hängen wir in der Wand. Jetzt sind die Kröne, Edelweiß, Blühen, wir klettern mit Sieger an. Heiliger Berg, jetzt so die Gehellen, Bergwagabunden sind wir, ja wie. Heiliger Berg, jetzt so die Gehellen, Bergwagabunden sind wir. Raudi, 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 Radio, Raudi, Radio, Raudi, Radio, Jaudi, Raudi, Raudi, Radio, Jaudi, Raudi, Raudi, Raudi. Somebody scream! Beim Alpenglühen, heimwärts beziehen die Pirnis, die Leute zurück. Wir kennen wieder, wenn wir sind Brüder, Brüder auf Leben und Tod. Wir wollen im Berg jetzt so nie gehehen, wir Kameraden sind treu, ja treu. Wir wollen im Berg jetzt so nie gehehen, wir Kameraden sind treu. Rauri, 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 Radio, Rauri, Radio, Rauri, Radio, Rauri, 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 Radio, Rauri, 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 Radio, Rauri, Radio, Rauri, Radio, Rauri, 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 Radio, Rauri, 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 Rauri,
ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Alex Meixner.